again guys, welcome back to the channel. In today's video we are taking a look at the newly released Big Radial's new Port 17. Many of you may already be familiar with Big Radial's, they brought their P-40 Tomahawk to the sim a few months ago. And the next instalment in their product line is the new Port 17, a French built World War I era fighter aircraft. The new Port 17 was introduced in March 1916, and the particular version that we're given here has the early 110 horsepower Lechon engine. The aircraft possessed outstanding manoeuvrability and excellent rates of climb, and was often described as the best pursuit plane of the day. So an interesting little fighter, and I think it's really nice that Big Radials have given us something a bit more unusual. As usual, we're going to carry out a full review, so we'll first take a look at the external modelling and texturing, then move inside and do the same with the cockpit. We'll carry out a full flight from start up to shutdown, and have a little bit of fun along the way as well. Today's flight should be an interesting one. It's based on a real-world Newport 17 flight. Quite an infamous one, actually. We'll be recreating the endeavours of Charles Godefroy, a World War I era French fighter pilot. He managed to write his name into the history books by flying a Newport 17 through the Arc de Triomphe. A tiny little bit of background history for those that are interested. France had actually planned a victory parade down the Champs-Élysées on the 14th of July 1919 to mark the end of the World War I hostilities. Military command had actually ordered that the airmen were to participate in the parade on foot. This was seen as a bit of a slight by the French fighter pilots, who of course had risked their lives in the air in their machines. And so it was decided that a pilot would be chosen to fly an aircraft through the Arc de Triomphe in protest of the decision. The flight ended up taking place on the 7th of August 1919. Godefroy took off at 7:20 a.m. from the Villacoublay airfield. He headed inbound towards the Seine, crossing the river at the Porte Maillot, and came in to fly down the Avenue de la Grande Armée through the Arc de Triomphe. Big Radials will actually be introducing a very similar bush trip with the first update for the aircraft, but we're going to make our own attempt at the flight today. As always guys, I do hope you enjoy the video. If you do, please consider giving it a like and subscribing to the channel. If you have any comments or questions for me, you can leave those down in the comment section below. For now though, let's continue on with our tour of the external model of the Newport 17. Okay, so starting with the external modelling of the aircraft, and I think overall Big Radials have done a very nice job with the Newport 17. I'll leave you to pick apart the finer points of the modelling, as it's not an aircraft that I'm all that familiar with, but certainly having looked at some pictures online and pictures I've seen in the past, the aircraft looks the part. On a macro scale, I think the detail of the modelling is actually very nice as well. There's no particularly obvious rough edges or areas lacking in polygon count. But that being said, there are areas where the poly count is a little bit on the lower side, but most of those areas you have to get pretty close in before you'll start to notice. The texturing of the aircraft, again, overall I think is very well done. I particularly like this paint scheme. I think there's about 5 to choose from memory. This particular livery is based on a real-world aircraft, and overall it looks to be done quite accurately. I particularly like the weathering and the texturing that Big Radials have given to the paint schemes. I think it makes the aircraft look rather more authentic. There are just a couple of areas where I think the textures are somewhat lacking, namely around the pilot. As you can see, the trousers there I think a little bit off in terms of shading and texturing. And the same really goes for the entirety of the pilot model. It's not the most convincing one I've seen in terms of modelling and texturing. That being said, it is really nice to see a custom effort. And again, from a distance, I think it holds up well enough. Most importantly, it is great to see that Big Radials have given the pilot a requisite and suitably sized moustache, otherwise I'm not sure that we'd be taking the aircraft flying today. But more seriously, overall, the level of detail throughout the aircraft is actually really nice, I think. They've paid a lot of attention to the finer points. As you can see, the Lechon engine modelled quite nicely there. The little Castrol oil canister, which you may have noticed throughout, again, I think a really nice little period touch. Coming down to the landing gear, and you can see that Big Radials have even modelled what I assume are some rubberised bungee cords to give the landing gear a little bit of suspension. We do have some chocks as well, although there are a couple of issues with those at the moment. We'll talk more about that during the conclusions of the review. And overall throughout the aircraft I think both the texturing and the modelling pretty nice. Here you can see the hinge on the left upper wing aileron, again 3D modelled, and the weathering on the roundel there pretty decent. So in summary, as far as the external modelling for the aircraft goes, I think the Big Radials have done a really nice job with the Newport 17. The modelling detail is certainly there throughout. There are a couple of areas that we've looked at with just a little bit lower poly count, but overall there's some really nice touches, and there's quite a few areas that have gone above and beyond in terms of attention to detail. In terms of the texturing, again, there are a few areas that could certainly be improved, but overall I think the texturing is really nice, and you do have to get in really close to notice any of the deficiencies. So the external model, definitely getting a thumbs up. I think a really nice job from Big Radials. Coming now down into the cockpit then, and as you can probably imagine, the Newport 17's cockpit is pretty spartan in terms of systems. Personally, I really like the cockpit. I think the Big Radials have pretty much got it spot on in terms of modelling and texturing. The instrumentation, whilst again pretty basic, is all done very nicely. It's all period authentic, all in French as well, which is great to see. Again, of course, there isn't a whole lot for you to play with in the cockpit, but everything that should work does, and there's nice switch sounds associated with that. As I say, I really like the texturing. It's very crisp, very clear, the detailing is nice, and I just think that everything is colourised quite accurately. There's no areas in the cockpit that I could really pick too much to fault, actually. And whilst it would be difficult to state whether or not an aircraft of this nature is quote-unquote study level, overall I think the systems modelling in the aircraft is really good. Big Radials also provide us with a nice little pop-out clipboard feature, which again has been done in an aesthetically sympathetic way to the aircraft. This will allow you to change a few options on the aircraft, as well as providing you with a basic checklist. In terms of options, we can choose to remove the upper body-mounted machine gun. Of course, this helps to improve vision out of the front of the aircraft, which is otherwise very limited in the Newport 17. We have the option to choose between kilometres an hour or knots on the airspeed indicator. The actual scale on the gauge doesn't change, but the needle will read accordingly. We can choose to switch out a very basic avionics suite, namely just a comm radio and a transponder. Although I think there's a slight bug here with the checklist at the moment, as it constantly shows deselected on the checklist itself. We can choose to show or hide the chocks, which you saw just a moment ago. Again, currently there is a little bit of an issue with those, but we'll talk more about that during the conclusion. And lastly, as I say, we can choose to present a very basic checklist and some performance data on the aircraft. So a few nice little options there. It's certainly great to be able to customise the aircraft to your taste. And as I say, I like the fact that the checklist has been done sympathetically and is quite discreet. Just finishing up with the texturing and the modelling of the cockpit, again, I couldn't really find any areas to fault. As you can see, even down in the footwell, the modelling detail is very nice, and again, I think the texturing is done rather accurately. The last little feature of the aircraft that I thought was a good bit of fun is that the machine guns do actually function. Just bear in mind though, if you do purchase the aircraft through the InSim marketplace, then the machine guns will not be included, I would imagine, in the final product. But as you can see, if we click on the trigger, the gun does actually fire. Both the overwing and the upper cowling machine gun function, and what I thought was a really cool little touch. I'm not sure as to whether or not the gun's actually modelled being jammed, I haven't managed to jam one myself yet. But hypothetically, if the gun were to jam, you can actually take the hammer on our left here, open up the cockpit windscreen, and give the gun a little bit of a bash to try and dislodge the jam. I thought that was a really nice little attention to detail. Overall, there are lots of nice little touches throughout the aircraft exactly like that. In short, I really like the modelling and the texturing of the Newport 17, and as I say, all of the little touches that Big Radials have clearly put into the aircraft. I don't mean it as a slight to the P40, but it's clear to see that as a developer they've learned a lot since their previous release. The Newport 17 certainly feels a lot more polished, a lot more mature than the P40. And as far as the aircraft model goes, I really like it. I think it's certainly done to a very nice standard given the price. Anyway, we've seen what the product has to offer visually. Let's now head for the cockpit and see how the Newport 17 actually flies. So hello and welcome to the cockpit of the Big Radials Newport 17. As you can imagine, the aircraft is fairly simple in terms of its systems, so there's not a whole lot we need to do to get the aircraft started up. Nonetheless, we'll run through the checklist. First item, fuel valve can go to open. The mixture can go fully forward. Throttle will open about 1 inch. Magnetos are both off. We'll bring the prop through a few turns just to make sure there's no vapor lock in the engine. And looks like we're all good on that front. So the mags can go on. We'll call contact and our helpful ground crew will hopefully spin the prop for us. And looks like we have a good start. Just adjust the throttle. The checklist calls for 1000 RPM, but I find that's probably a little bit high in the aircraft. It tends to jump its chocks otherwise. And the RPM gauge is quite unique, one of those typically older designs, and as much as you have to actually be aware of the current engine state, the first rotation around the gauge is up to 1000 RPM and the second rotation around up to 2000 RPM. So again, you have to be quite conscious of what the engine's doing already. Anyway, we'll come up to around 700 RPM. I find that works out quite nicely. Get the ground crew to remove the chocks. and we'll make our way over towards the runway, which is just off R1 o'clock, so we'll come full back on the stick. We're not going to be using any air traffic control systems today. Firstly, it's not very period accurate, of course, and secondly, I don't think they'll be giving us clearance to fly underneath the Arc de Triomphe. Overall, I actually really like the ground handling of the Viewport 17. I think it's very well done. There's no brakes on the aircraft, so you've really got to be mindful of what you're doing. Also, the turning radius is nothing special, so you really want to keep the taxi as straight as you can, avoid turning too much, and give yourself plenty of distance, particularly on the landing, to get the aircraft slowed down. Just got the tail skid to do that for you. As you can see, it is a case of just managing the power. You might find yourself coming to a stop there, as I did, which is obviously suboptimal, but certainly preferable to running out of room and not being able to stop the aircraft in time. Anyway, we'll just get ourselves lined up on the runway, carry out the last of our checks. And obviously, in reality, an aircraft like the Newport 17 really just designed to be taking off from a field, so you can more or less point the aircraft whichever way is into wind if you've got the space. It's not really designed for taxiing. Anyway, bringing her to a stop, we'll just come up slightly again on the throttle to keep the engine ticking over, but we obviously don't want the aircraft moving forward if we can avoid it. Before takeoff checks, really just a flight control check. So, checking the ailerons. Quite an interesting little mechanism here up on the wings. I'm not entirely sure what that's for, but at a guess, it does look like you can actually control the aircraft while standing up and changing the magazine or trying to fire the gun. Even if it's not designed to do that, I imagine it could be used in such fashion. Anyway, checking the elevator and the rudder, so we have full free and in the correct sense on the controls. And when I first got into the aeroplane, I have to admit, I thought maybe a little bit of a modelling error from big radials in terms of the wing. It looks incredibly thin, incredibly small, but the Viewport 17 is actually, as I understand it, a sesquiplane. I think that's how you pronounce it, which is quite interesting. Never come across one of those before, but essentially it has a normal larger sized wing on the top and a much smaller wing on the bottom. So really it's sort of halfway between a monoplane and a biplane, which I thought was quite interesting. Anyway, we'll have a quick glance at our gauges. Everything looking more or less as it should be there. We'll just head outside briefly, take a quick look at the external view with the engine running, and then we'll come back. We'll be ready for the takeoff. So we are all set and ready to go, no brakes to worry about, so we'll just come up on the throttle. Slowly feeding in that power. Just using a little bit of rudder here to keep us straight. Overall, the rudder response actually feels very nice. RPM's checked, nose coming down. Overall, the rudder is actually really good. It's very easy to control the aircraft on the takeoff roll. And it felt pretty nice. Anyway, we are airborne, currently heading out towards the southwest. We want to be heading out towards the southeast. So we'll make a 90 degree left turn. I'm not going to worry too much about our altitude or our speed today. I imagine flying something like this is very much a seat of the pants feel most of the time anyway. So that puts us on a southeasterly heading, obviously pretty tricky to navigate accurately with such a compass. Overall, as I say, the aircraft's actually really nice to fly. It's very light on the controls, feels very nimble. I would say in the sound department so far, the engine sounds are perhaps a little bit anemic, both internally and externally. I'm definitely noticing a lack of wind noise at the moment as well, which I do feel does remove from the immersion just a little bit. You can already see Paris actually, just off the left, you can see the central business district just out at our 10 o'clock. And I'm not entirely sure, but I suspect that might be the Eiffel Tower that we can see off on our left. Another little airfield just off our 11 o'clock. Looks like we've got someone else departing. Already above him, but we'll stay out to the right just to keep an eye on him for now. And we'll level off roughly at our present altitude. Come back slightly on the power. Lost our fellow aviator at the moment, but no major concern there anyway. Doubt he's going to be following us on our present flight plan. But again, overall the aircraft's actually really nice. It's really good fun to fly, it feels very much as you would expect. There's the Palace of Versailles, just off at our 2 o'clock there. As I say, we'll keep pointed towards the CBD for now. Instrumentation, of course, is very basic. We've just got the airspeed indicator, that's in kilometres an hour, although you can actually switch over to knots as well. We've got our compass, accurate even with the French O there for wests. And we've got our altimeter. Finally, we've got our RPM gauge and our trusty old clock. So there is just about enough there to actually fly the aircraft, do a little bit of navigation, albeit, as I said, it would be quite difficult to do that accurately, I think, with the compass. I'll see on the left we've got our fuel gauge, which is really just a little bubble level there with the ball. And we've got our hammer, just in case we need to unjam the guns en route. Yeah, so you can see the Eiffel Tower just out at our 1 o'clock. We'll stop off there on the way home, I think. The aircraft does feel a little bit more powerful than I was expecting, but I believe that the Newport 17 actually was quite powerful for its time. Again, overall the aircraft feels very nice and roll. It's quite responsive on the controls. That's max deflection on the ailerons. But it's great fun for cruising around like this, taking in this sort of scenery. If anyone saw my flight in the Durand, I can imagine it would be really good fun to do a similar sort of trip in this aircraft. Just come up slightly again on the power here, we're getting a little bit low in terms of our altitude. That will come up to full power again for the moment. And again, that RPM gauge, a little bit tricky to read. I suspect we're doing 2200 RPM at the moment. So we'll head out towards the CBD, just out to the east of that is the Port Mallot. I have to forgive my pronunciations. That's one of the old entrances into the city of Paris, where the old fortified walls were. Quite a famous location in the city. We'll basically head down the Avenue de la Grande Armée. That takes in towards the Arc de Triomphe. Altitude's looking a little bit better again now, so we'll come back on the power once again. See the River Seine just off the left wing. That snakes its way in and out of Paris. One thing I did note, and I would like to see, would be really nice when we open up the forward window there. There's no change in sound either of the engine, or again, it'd be nice to have some wind noise, so maybe a little improvement there from big radials. Really, as I say, I think the sound is just the one area of the aircraft so far which is a little bit less up to standard than the rest of the package. We'll climb just a little bit more here just to enable us to make out the visual features that we'll need to find the correct route. That will just come all the way up to full power again. It's really a requirement in the Newport 17, it seems, that we need full power to really gain any altitude, as you would expect. And just keeping an eye out for the Seine at the moment so that we can find the Port Malotte. Come back off the power again now. So as I say, we have the River Seine. I think the Port Malotte is just off our 11 o'clock. Looks like we've got the train lines down below us there on the left. So everyone keep your eyes peeled for the Arc de Triomphe. Can't make it out just yet. See roughly where it should be, but we need to come in from the right direction, obviously, to fly through the gap in the middle. Okay, so we've got it just out at our 1 o'clock. So the Port Malotte just off the left wing, and this is the Avenue de la Grande Armée just down below us. So we'll dip the nose down, we'll build up some speed. Pretty small gap to fit the aircraft through overall. Basically, the gap is twice as wide as the aircraft, more or less, if I remember correctly. We're going full chat here at the moment. We've got full throttle. Still feels like quite a leisurely pace by modern standards, particularly given that I've just been flying the F-16I DCS. And I have to say, that gap does look rather small. I'm always up for a challenge in the sim, but I think if that was reality, I'd be feeling a little bit nervous about now. Nonetheless, I think we're going to be okay. So, through the middle we go. Anyway, as I said, I think we should take a stop off at the Eiffel Tower before we depart. I think it would be a little bit rude not to. And since we seem to be in the habit of flying three things today, I think we're going to have to fly underneath that as well, aren't we? I have to say, the Eiffel Tower is actually one of my favourite monuments in the world that I've seen. I think, I don't know why exactly, but I just always find it so impressive to look at. And actually, seeing pictures of it, I was always a bit underwhelmed, but seeing it in reality is just a totally different beast. Whereas there are other monuments around the world that look amazing on paper, but when you actually see them, a little bit disappointing. Anyway, much easier flying through there, of course. And again, overall, the aircraft is just really good fun to fly. Very easy on the controls. feel we're getting a little bit slow here now. The elevator's getting pretty heavy and the ailerons are getting rather sloppy. Anyway, we'll make our way back home. We'll perform a few manoeuvres before we land just to see how the aircraft feels in that department. We'll go back more or less the way we've come, so we'll head back towards the CBD initially. And I do remember that little hill we passed straight over the top of that, so we'll point the aircraft towards that. Anyway, as usual, I always like to take a little bit of a look at the external model of the aircraft as well, so I think what we'll do, we'll head outside, we'll take in some of the views as we head back towards the airbase, and give you a bit of a closer look at the Newport 17 now that we're in flight. As usual, I'll come back to you just as we arrive at the airfield and we make our approach into land. So welcome back. As you can see, we are just approaching home base at the moment, and I have to say that's one of the things I really like about the Newport 17 is the visibility overall is pretty excellent. Somewhat limited out the front, but of course we do have the choice to remove the machine gun there. Nonetheless, overall, really nice aircraft for enjoying the scenery, as I mentioned. As you'll see, we've gained a little bit of altitude since we left the city of Paris. Obviously, the Newport 17 does have a little bit of fighter heritage, so I thought it would only be right that we throw the aircraft around a little bit, see how it responds. So we'll just try a few manoeuvres. Try a steep turn out to the left initially. Again, the roll rate's really nice overall, the controls are really smooth. We'll come fully back on the stick. Rate of turn is reasonable, to be expected from a almost biplane. And the speed not really reducing a whole lot there as we pull that G. Try a power on stall. So we do get a little bit of buffeting sound there, which is nice. And we'll fall back on the stick. The left wing dropping there, we do go into a spin. That's nice to see. We'll release the stick. And the spin corrects. Fortunately though, that has given us a little bit of a problem there. Lost the engine momentarily. It seems we got that back. And that is modelled, so at least I managed to demonstrate that to you inadvertently. Later on, when we come in for the approach, as you'll see, we'll have to actually blip the throttle. And if you blip the throttle for too long, you can actually lose the engine. Anyway, last manoeuvre we'll try. We'll just do a loop, and then we'll come back for a landing. So we've got full throttle, pitch the nose down. Build up some airspeed. I wonder if the engine's not cutting out there because we're over revving it. Anyway, fully back on the stick. Over the top of the loop. Come off the throttle this time, trying to avoid over revving the engine. Yeah, so overall I think the aircraft actually handles very nicely. It's arguably doesn't feel study level in terms of its flight model, but it feels very plausible and it's really good fun to fly. We'll come back onto the runway from which we departed, so we'll basically come overhead the field at the moment. We're on a bit of a crosswind leg to join into the pattern here. Again, not too much in the way of checks, but brakes are definitely off because we don't have any. Undercarriage is down. Mixture is rich. Fuel pump we don't have. Fuel quantity. As you can see, we've only burned through maybe 10-15% of our fuel there, so you can probably fly for a couple of hours in this thing. Instruments are checked. Landing light we don't have. Harness is secure. Although, quite possibly, actually, we didn't even have one of those in an aircraft of this period. So we'll come onto our downwind leg. Again, you can come back on the throttle and that will reduce the engine power to some degree, which as you can see we are losing a little bit of altitude here at the moment, but we also need to blip the throttle if we really want to lose some engine power, which the button for that is just on the top of the stick and you can assign a button to that in the sim. Just try that now, just for demonstration purposes. You can hear that kills the engine. But the manual does advise you don't want to use that for too long a period of time, as I say, you can damage the engine and apparently even cause an engine fire, so to be used sparingly, I think. Anyway, at the moment, profile's looking pretty good without blipping the throttle. We'll just control with the throttle for now. And according to the checklist, we want to land on the main gear first, so we won't be looking for a three-point landing. Make sure we don't land too long. Again, we don't have any brakes, so all we can rely on is the tail skid to slow us down. So fully back on the throttle at the moment. I think we're just a touch high here at the moment, so we will blip the throttle. And give it another blast there. And one more for luck. So not too bad overall, although we there you go, so if you do blip the throttle for too long you can indeed cause the engine to cut out. Anyway, there's touchdown. So coming back on the stick, that'll put the tail skid onto the ground, help slow us down. We'll just come off to the left so that we vacate the runway. Looks like we don't have much choice. We're going to have to wait for our ground crew to come over and rescue us. We are just about clear of the runway at least. Anyway, as usual, we'll just head outside the aircraft to finish up the video. We'll discuss the pros and cons of the Big Radial's Newport 17. So there you go guys, I hope you enjoyed our little recreation of Charles Godefroy's flight through the Arc de Triomphe, and indeed the demonstration of the Big Radial's Newport 17. As usual, I'll try and give you a little bit of a breakdown on the product in terms of my thoughts and feelings. We'll start with the negative points and work our way through to the good. In terms of the negatives, I wouldn't say there's any glaring errors on the product, although there are certainly a few areas I would like to see polished up a little bit. The only area I would say that needs little refinement is the aircraft sounds. Overall, I think those could use a little bit more detail just to create a bit more immersion. Certainly, I was noticing a lack of wind sound throughout the flight, which makes things feel a little bit off in an open cockpit aircraft. It would be nice as well to hear the wind whipping over the struts and the bracing wires, and a little bit more creaking and groaning as we pull some G in the aircraft, as opposed to the default Microsoft Flight Simulator sounds. Overall, the sounds certainly aren't bad, and I think the engine sounds quite nice, although it perhaps just needs a little bit more bass note. It's really just that the sounds aren't up to the same high standards as the rest of the aircraft. The rest of my negative points regarding the Newport 17, as I say, it's really just details that need refining and fixing up by Big Radials. And I'm sure that they'll do that. As a developer, they've been very consistent with fixing up issues with the P40, as well as listening to customer feedback on improvements for the aircraft. The most significant issue I think I had with the aircraft was the chocks. They don't currently seem to keep the aircraft in place. It definitely had a bit of a tendency to roll backwards, which you might expect given that the chocks are only inserted at the front of the wheels. But generally speaking, the sim chocks are used a little bit like a park brake. You want to keep the aircraft stationary, and it was also very easy to jump the chocks. They didn't seem to have much resistance against the engine power, so I think a little bit of work needed there. Similarly, I found when hand starting the engine that that functionality didn't always work, and it seemed to me that that perhaps was down to an issue with a Phantom flat battery. I found if I left the aircraft sitting for too long, then I couldn't start the engine. Control E did do the trick, so we were still able to get the aircraft started, but it would be nice to see the systems reworked slightly so that we can hand start the engine at any time. And my last couple of issues with the aircraft were graphical, relating specifically to the engine in flight. The rotary engine itself, I could be wrong, but it looked to me like a 2D sprite, which was good enough. It looked quite nice from a distance, but again, up close, perhaps a bit more noticeable. The other slight modelling deficiency that I noticed was at certain angles you couldn't actually see the prop shaft connecting the propeller to the engine. So there are a few little areas for improvement, as I said, but overall I'm pretty confident the big radials will see to those in due course. As I say, when it came to their P40 release, they were very good at fixing up any issues with that aircraft, so I have no reason to doubt they'll do the same with the Newport 17. In terms of my positives for the product, overall I have to say it's a really strong offering from Big Radials, particularly given the price of the product. As I said in the introduction, I like the fact that they've chosen a slightly more unusual, slightly more unique aircraft. It's always nice to get the option to fly something a little bit different in the sim. As I mentioned earlier, I really like all of the little attentions to detail that Big Radials have given the aircraft. It certainly feels like a lot of love and attention has gone into the product. The little Castrol oil can on the ground, the working machine guns, the French instrumentation, the stitching around the cockpit, overall throughout the detailing is really nice. And although it's a little bit gimmicky, a little bit funny, even having that hammer to unjam the gun I thought was a really nice touch. It goes to show that the Newport 17 really has been a labour of love for Big Radials. In terms of the flight modelling, overall I thought the aircraft was really pleasant to fly. Again, I wouldn't necessarily call the flight model study level, although I do think, again, the sounds probably have a part to play in that. A2A are very good at playing the trick of giving you feedback through sounds with the aircraft, and really I just felt like I wasn't getting a whole lot of feedback from the aircraft. But overall, the aircraft, as I say, is a joy to fly, and it behaves very plausibly for an aircraft of the period. And lastly, just touching on the aircraft's FPS, overall it's a big thumbs up in that department. I was getting about 6 FPS more than I was with the default Cessna 152, so the Newport 17, a very FPS-friendly aircraft. As I say, overall I really enjoyed my time out with the product. It's very nice to fly, and the visibility is great as well. It's really nice for cruising around the countryside. I think it's a really great offering from Big Radials, again, particularly given the price, which I think is more than fair. Once again, I think the Newport 17 shows that Big Radials have learned a lot since their P40 release. It seems that they've really started to mature as a developer, and they're putting out some really nice products. The Newport 17 is retailing for $25 Australian, so if this is the sort of aircraft that you're into, I would recommend at that sort of price that it's well worth taking a look. Anyway guys, as always, I do hope you enjoyed the video and found it to be of use. Once again, if you did, please consider giving the video a like and subscribing to the channel. If you have any comments or questions for me, you can leave those down in the comment section below, and I'll always do my best to answer them. And as ever, thank you ever so much to my channel members and patrons for all of your support. It's hugely appreciated. I hope wherever you are, you have a great day, and I will see you all again soon.